the announcer to welcome Cheryl Wilson-Smith from Red Lake. So her show 21 Pillows opens today. So I'll hand the floor over to Cheryl, who will tell us a bit more about her work.
Thank you. I was going to rush up here to be beside you, but then I realized I'll trip you and you'll be in trouble with it. So I'm super excited to be here. This building is amazing. The Douglas Family Art Center, called PMI, the Richardson Gallery, and then Susan Glass and Artie Personson, Lounge. It's an amazing place, and I think you guys should rent it out because I want to be out there all the time. It'll be my new rest stop in Kenora. So just bear with me. This technology is all new for me, and I'm struggling a wee bit. So I'm going to ask you all to indulge me and close your eyes for a moment. Slowly breathe in. Really feel the breath going through your nose and filling your lungs. Now breathe out. Open your eyes. That one breath is gone and can never come back. Every breath, everything in our lives is passing. But I think with COVID, many of us are more aware than ever. I currently live in Red Lake, where I'm constantly reminded of our transience. Embracing that has allowed me to examine it through my work. Thanks to all of you. You know how they say it takes a village to raise a child? Well, it takes many communities to raise an artist. I'm fortunate enough to have grown up in Kenora, and this community will always be home. An amazing friend and mentor likes to say our work is a reflection of self. That thought is a bit scary for me. I live surrounded by the manifestations of nature, relatively untouched by humans. The rocks, trees, and lakes are a reminder that I am only passing by. Those trees were here long before me and will be here long after me. I strive to reflect nature's graceful strength in my work. Through this work, I contemplate our connection to nature, genetic memory, and the evanescence of life. At the same time, I'm aware of what can't be seen. This is a tailings pond from our local mine. I drive by the lake and the pond regularly. I'm aware of the impact of both on my art. So back to where I live. My feeling of transience is partially due to this. I live 2 hours north of the Trans-Canada, where the highway ends. To go further north, you must fly or portage. Has anybody here been to Red Lake? Ooh, you guys are cool. I've lived in Northern Ontario for most of my life. The impressions of rocks, lakes, and snow have been scribed on my soul. I am inspired at every turn by our surroundings. For example, the granite rock that displays the tenacious survival of lichens. The wilderness was my childhood sanctuary, always an escape and an adventure. It's about the tiniest wildflower living their solitary life. It's about the more secretive lives no one ever sees hidden under a decaying log. It's about being on the water and seeing the richness that surrounds me. All of this nurtures my creative process. The good part of living here is the beauty and the seclusion. The difficult part of living here is the isolation. But the ice roads we travel on in winter make for great stories when we go to Southern Ontario. An endless inspiration. I believe the intensity of our winters and the completeness of the isolation gives us a sense of survival and resilience. Red Lake, like Kenora, gives us the opportunity to raise kids in a unique setting. This is my son going to school in about grade 7 or 8. I can't deny that it's often challenging and frustrating to live in a small community. The benefits of isolation as an art for an artist are substantial. quiet ease of being truly alone, spending time in solitude, being forced to be with myself, is deeply valuable. One of the benefits of this isolation is that I have sought connections from around the globe with like-minded people and thinkers who have become my community. Technology has allowed me to reach out and connect on my own terms. I am always amazed at the helping hands I receive when I pass. I could not have done it without the generosity of artists, like the amazing Canadian glass artist who happens to be with us today, Ione Burkelson, Jamie Gray, sorry, yes! Jamie Gray, Bob Leatherbarrow, Jerry Davidson, George Whitney, and Bob Bamford, to name only a few. I hope we can all be as generous when we are asked. Knowing what glass artists are doing around the world has raised the bar for me on what is possible and to help me grow as an artist. It's allowed me to constantly study and network nationally and internationally. And now with COVID, we were just talking about this, we have so many opportunities to study and learn. It seems almost endless. This is one of my first pieces that was made in this layered style. It was selected for a show in 2011 at the Ball Museum of Glass in Muncie, Indiana. The juror was Catherine Gray. If you've watched the series on Netflix, Blown Away, she's the lady that walks around asking all the questions. When all the people in Red Lake were seriously thinking I was crazy, she believed enough to include me in the show and change my world. The roots of my art are in my past. This is my grandma's needlework that hangs in my house. Both my mom and my grandma did needlework. Here's a quilt my grandma made. Oops. Here's a quilt my grandma made in 1939. It hangs in my hallway. Look at these circles, each one the size of a loonie. The yo-yo quilt is made for a queen-size bed, and it represents hours and hours of her life. It connects me to an interesting time in world history and my personal history. Oh, sorry I messed up on this slide. My dad welded and carved and seemed to make whatever we needed as kids. And my mom did needlework and lace. Another profound influence on me is that I was always involved in aviation. I got my pilot's license at the age of 21. I love to fly and still marvel at the possibilities of flight and the magnificent inventions we as humans have created. I am aware at the same time of the contradictions of these inventions. These beautiful little spheres, worthy of any artist, are part of a guided missile. I have always painted. Here is one of my early efforts. Here's another. A recent teacher put my painting ability in perspective when he told me that the good news was I had unlimited potential for improvement. I then began in clay. The landscape made me want to create in 3D. Fortunately, there was a lady in Red Lake that taught clay classes. I think all artists' lives are a unique combination of design and accident. For many years, with funding from the Ontario Arts Council, I shared my love of art with children in our community school. The income helped sustain me as an artist, and it reminded me of two critical things: playing without fear and being able to just do. It's an amazing gift. I've also taken part in community projects to help give back. This was a street mural project. The best thing about it for me, other than these amazing kids, was every person that walked by gave the kids positive feedback. Not one person said anything negative to the kids. Clay also led me to be included in my first art show in Kenora that Chris organized. It was right next door in the museum. better than my paintings, right? After several years in clay, I got my kiln, leaving them a lifelong study of how to fire things. I was never completely happy working in clay, so I discovered glass through an Australian pottery magazine that we used to get in our drugstore. Serendipity again. I began simply slumping glass, and I was so excited when I did that. This is a cast ling. I found the ling on the beach, and I coated it in this smooth-on silicone rubber. My husband always had the fun job of unmolding these things after they sat outside for 24 hours. I did birds, fish, snakes, and my freezer is still a place of terror for small children. This is one of my favorites, Gentleman's Agreement in cast glass. It's the beginning of narrative work for me. During my long apprenticeship, my children were the subjects of many learning experiments. They always threatened me by threatening to call child and family. Here, for example, the mold stuck to the hair on his arms and legs. But I persevered. My body castings landed me my first solo show at, where? Definitely Superior Artist Run Gallery in Thunder Bay. So we're going to leap ahead to 2006. Dryden had a call to artists to apply to create for their training center. I was so naive, I applied. And then I was awarded the Palm Atrium space. I had no idea what I was getting into. Each of these pods is clay. It's about 2.5 feet high. I had 3 months to make over 100 pieces of glass that were 18 by 18 and 6 millimeters thick. So I worked literally night and day. I'd load the kiln every 8 hours, most nights requiring me to get up at 2 or 3 in the morning. And of course, this was one of our famous winters where it's minus 40. Even though my studio is only a 10-minute drive away, it was not pleasant. But working this intensely helped me build skill and confidence. This is from 2009. It was a job at our local Heritage Swoops Center. It's a donor wall. It's 11 feet by 21 feet, and it was one of my biggest learning experiences. This took me over 2 years, and I learned all about contracts and agreements. Thank you, Carfax. And I learned how to speed dial my lawyer. In 2014, I was confident or crazy enough to bid on a restaurant job in Winnipeg. This is from Carnival Restaurant. Yes, I got the job. And it taught me a very important lesson that I'm not cut out for this kind of work. I am obviously a really slow learner. I was a mess the whole time. We were installing for various reasons. I also carried each one of these ribbons half a block, in minus 40 again, with blowing wind down the slippery streets of Winnipeg. You guys don't use salt. There were over 200 pieces. This is when I put my therapist on speed dial. During these years, I had part of my husband's business in the retail space in Red Lake. And I did craft shows in Winnipeg, Dryden, Thunder Bay, Grand Marais, loading, unloading. It's amazing what you can do when you're 30. Well, maybe 40. But I never stopped exploring landscape, time, and layering. The passage of time is constant, like the layers in my work. These two young men, my sons, have manifested for me the passage of time. You really get a sense of time. Watching children grow at what seems like lightning speed, sharing the traditions of family and stories of ancestors with them. Helping them prepare for their future, it really makes you aware that you're such a small part of history. Glass is the perfect medium to explore the thought of passage of time as its own rich traditions have been handed down through the generations. It takes a great deal of time to master its fragility and strength. It resounds with insignificance. At one moment, a strong, vibrant object, the next, shattered and discarded. As I have already alluded, I believe you must be an independent spirit to live your life as an artist in a remote community and take the occasional risk in order to move forward. One of my biggest risks was taking a mentorship 6 years ago that was offered through Fusion Clay and Glass in Southern Ontario. The mentor was the amazing Kuhn van der Stucken, who was the head of class at Sheridan, to whom I am extremely and forever grateful. It allowed me to connect with artists across Canada and introduced me to a whole new world. Kuhn's questioning, encouragement, and his belief in me propelled my work forward at an accelerated pace. Through his encouragement, I applied for a residency and in 2014 was able to attend a glass residency with Professor Mark Ganter at the University of Washington in order to explore direct 3D printing or vitroglyphic printing, a process they have pioneered. I needed to examine how the mechanical 3D process relates to my own manual process. So after nagging Professor Ganter to death, something I'm very good at, just ask my husband, he relented. And with the help of a GAP scholarship and a Fusion Award, I was able to attend. For this residency, I needed to learn Rhino. This is how I used to design. In Rhino, the scaling of objects, rotation, and visualization became much quicker. It was thought-provoking for me to design an object and create it that my hands never touched. I simply designed the object and pushed print on the computer. This caused me to take some time to contemplate the nature of my process. The act of just doing it becomes an embedded part of both my vision and emotional content in my work. It allows me to connect with the viewer on a deeper level. The exploration of 3D printing allowed me to see the possibilities and encouraged me to continue with the process of handmade. I believe there's something invaluable in work made by hand. So after this residency, I was encouraged by friends to get out there. It was not an easy decision because I had faced a lot of rejection. Inspired by a girlfriend, Debbie Evans, I agreed to say yes to any opportunity for 1 year. Sorry. This was the Artist Project in Toronto. And what I will miss most about going to these shows in Southern Ontario is this: when people saw where I was from, because they always had where you were, they would share their stories of coming to the North with me. There were some incredible stories, and it feels like quite a privilege. In 2014, I was lucky enough to win the RBC Award for Glass. And I was also a finalist with honorable mention in the International Emerge competition. This recognition led to an invitation for a residency at Kilchuck School of Glass. The school was built by Dale Chihuly, and for those of you who don't know, it's in Washington at the foot of the Cascade Mountains, and it's like a religious retreat for glass artists. It was my first experience being in a large group of like-minded people, that we were all working on glass. It was interesting to be amongst artists who genuinely liked you and your work. I encourage each of you to connect with like-minded individuals. It really does help. As a result of the RBC Award for Glass, I was able to attend a residency, this is kind of hard to see, sorry, with 13 other glass artists in Norway. I bought them all the famous poop tubes. Most of our time is spent in Berlevang, north of the Arctic Circle, by the side of the house you see the reindeer, which roam free, much like Kenora's deer do. We were north of the Arctic Circle, and they thought it was cold here. It was virtually balmy. It was minus 15 every day. But the wind was incredible. This photo was taken on the day we were leaving. They have gate arms that come down and close off the road. And then we would travel in a convoy behind the snowplow for 3 hours south. But it's actually not a bad idea. Some days, coming from Red Lake, I'd really like that. It was beautiful and isolated, just like home. This residency again furthered my work and shifted my perspective. I now look at where I live a little differently. I realize that all the rich details of the landscape in Norway surround me here as well. I now make a conscious effort to pay attention. 2016 found me exploring the Scottish landscape at Northland's Creative Glass, funded in part by the Ontario Arts Council, where I was able to search for ancestors and explore memory. We were invited to a harvest festival. This gentleman was a farmer, picked to share his year with the whole crowd. It was a large room. He could name every one of his tractors. I never heard his wife's name once. I was enthralled with the tradition of sharing your year with a community. Okay, now hold on, this makes sense. So as the video makes clear, this gentleman on the accordion and the dancing made me long for the past, but realizing the past is alive and thriving in this part of Scotland. So it was a harvest festival where we had a great dinner with all home cooked vegetables. Whoops. Technology is a challenge. And I've never seen people dance like this before. Two of the favorites were Canadian Barn Dance and Strip the Willow. And the amazing part for me, this young Vaughan woman is Carlin Sutherland. She's a glass artist from Leicester. She had been in fascinating. Before I left for Scotland, my husband brought me a brief ancestry inquiry into my grandmother's side of the family. I read it before I left, but really did not understand the geography. My Scotland geography sucks. Once we were driving around, I was noticing the towns. So I went back through and read the family history. Many people ask me why I did the work I do. I have all kinds of answers, all of which I believe. And I knew my family was from near Leicester, Northland's glass studio. For those of you familiar, it's Thurso and Lather and Weal is the area. With the help of the amazing Lorna, Northland's creative, she told me exactly where my great-great-grandmother's house was, which is 15 minutes from the glass studio. So I discovered my family history and discovered rock formations that I had never seen before, which looked surprisingly like my work. I've always wondered where my ideas come from, and this residency connected me to my artistic DNA. This trip didn't answer all of my questions, but it feels like it's brought me closer. From realizing where my ideas may come from, and watching a society that continues to pour stories and traditions into living memory, like the layering of my work, we're always in the midst of the passage of time. I am grateful to the Ontario Arts Council. The Ontario Arts Council and the Chalmers Family Fund. They've awarded me a Chalmers Fellowship to continue to explore genetic memory and the relationship between my work and my past. This research will continue once COVID has changed again and we're back to normal. Or whatever that's going to be. I was thrilled to be invited to participate in Chicago SOFA in 2015 and 2016. It was on my bucket list. Another important piece is Promises and Lies, Keeping Score. The stacks of paper were reminiscent of those nails restaurants used to have. You used to pay your bill and they used to stick the receipt. So it's the accumulation of the totals of the promises and the lies. This got me into Emerge 2016 in the States again. Emerge, so you know, is a bullseye glass competition, and it's international, so it's quite fun to be part of it. This was at a show in Atlanta, the Marietta Claw Museum of Art. They normally don't let Canadian artists into their gallery, and I was with a group of American artists, and they originally said, no, you can't go. And then I pleaded my case, and they let me in. So I was quite happy with them. This is how I look when I work. It's very dusty and very dirty. To create my sculptures, I pass frit through screens, like silk screens, frit is crushed gloss, layer by layer, much like manual 3D printing, and I fire them as a whole in the kiln. The temperature is a sinter temperature, and it varies from kiln to kiln and piece to piece. Every time I put something in the kiln, it's an experiment. Uncovering these is akin to an archaeological dig. It's pretty fun. I relinquish my work to the kiln and hope it works its magic as designed. I currently have several kilns. I fire almost continuously. My biggest is 6 feet by 30 inches. Okay, now everybody has to hold onto your seats. This is scary. This next part. Here's my studio. I'm fortunate to have the basement of an old dance hall in Red Lake. I think it's 40 by 80 feet, so it's quite large. And the colors of glass I use to paint, as a painter would use. So this brings us to this moment. 4 years ago, I was asked by the Thunder Bay Art Gallery to do a show, and they generously set no restrictions. I spent 2 years working on the project, 21 Pillows, which seems like a long time, but having the gift of working that intensely really does allow you to learn. Projects have a long incubation time for me. I am influenced by the 20 plus years I've spent in Red Lake, observing environmental practices. This photo is just north of Aberdeen, Scotland. We were driving by, and it was my epiphany moment. I was contemplating the contradiction between the oil platform and the farmland, because of course my great-grandfather William was a farmer. And I realized there's really no contradiction. We all have a part in altering the landscape. So when I wanted to do the installation, I knew I wanted this part, this area north of Red Lake, to be a part of it. It's been fascinating for me. It's a moraine left by the Ice Age. It runs lengthwise through the bush. We would often go there with the kids to play on the rocks. And I could never resist holding, picking up, and taking home some of these rocks. I believe rock has memory, and it holds energy. So I love it when people want to touch my work, whatever show we're at, so I wanted to combine these two experiences. So to hold the glass rocks I have created and place them in the environment we have built allows everybody to share the energy and create the landscape. These stones were invented by my desire to add earth elements to this project. I began by adding sand. It's these little rocks you see down there. If you feel them, you'll find they're incredibly light. The pillows are, for me, are a reference to the landscape. They have been through several iterations to get to this point. The layout of the pillows in a grid is reference to the longitude and latitude of the earth. And the pillows themselves remind me of those tufted pillows on my grandma's couch. Those beautiful throw pillows, but like the land, they accept us, our decisions, comfort, and sustain us. This installation has been a long time in the making. The 2 years spent creating 10,000 glass rocks led me to many realizations and some deep learning. As the landscape has changed in the world by our presence, each of you can be a part of the ongoing shaping of this installation. I hope each of you will pick up a stone and place it anywhere you're drawn to. In the Richardson Family Gallery. I do not expect what we see here today will be there tomorrow. But it'll be interesting to see what we can all create. I'm anxious to see how this changes and evolves over time with your help. Thanks to the Canada Council for the Art and the Ontario Arts Council, the Thunder Bay Art Gallery, the Muse in particular, Lori, Sophie, and Shelby, and thanks to all of you.
And if you're on Facebook Live, you can comment a question and we'll read it to Cheryl. But you guys in here, go ahead.
Cheryl, do you worry about damage or destruction to any of your rocks, or is that part of it?
That's okay. Part of it.
Because some of them are going to
chip. But I think it's more valuable to have the experience of holding it and interacting than to worry about the chip.
And how did you move it to get it here?
How did we move it? We have a trailer, and these guys helped us. It's all boxed, and they hauled it in rollers. They were great. Took us way less time than I thought. We were only about half an hour unloading. So it's great. But each of those, the layered rocks, each of the layered rocks is wrapped in its own individual bubble bag.
Oh, my God.
So these guys are not going to be happy when they have to pack it up. But so they had to go and wrap each of those layered stones. Yeah. And these are put in a layer in the box and foamed in between each layer. So they're not as bad. But yeah. Yes?
Does the show have a title?
21 Pillows, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. I didn't see it. And you must have mentioned it.
No, maybe I didn't. Who knows?
And does the number 21 have any significance?
Just the number of pillows in the show, and I was struggling for a name. So
okay.
I wish I had a really cool answer for that one.
That's okay.
Yes.
What's inside the pillows?
Chipped foam, which I actually had a great deal of trouble sourcing. So it came out of the States several years ago. The only place I could find it in Canada was out of Edmonton, and it was quite expensive. So. Yeah. I thought chipped foam was common, but I'm old. So I haven't done pillows for 30 years. Yeah. Anything else? Just ask.
So I'm a bit surprised when you say so much of your inspiration came when you visited Highlands in Scotland. Because when I look at your photos, and by the way, your photos are stunning. Mm-hmm. Okay, you also paper tall, which you are. But when I look at your photos and I look at the geography around where you live, your work is very much of that as well. So it's certainly, it echoes what is part of your heritage, but it's very much what seems to be where you live.
I'm very confused.
No.
No, I always thought it was, I always thought it was a boreal forest and where I live that did it. But the minute I saw those landscape, the rocks from Cape Ness, I was stunned. I think I walked around for the whole week. Because I've never seen anything like that. And I'm sure there's other rock formations in the world like that. It just made me aware of genetic memory or start researching it. And I honestly have to say I am a believer after a year and a half of research. I do believe that there's something there. But maybe I can somehow by the end of the Chalmers Fellowship realize why they're both incorporated, or I'm not sure. Thank you.
But then the Chalmers, what would be the end point of the Chalmers?
Oh, I get to go to, I'm obviously rather excited. I've done a year's research, which involved mainly reading. And now I get to go to Scotland for 4 months and study the landscape. So, yeah, once COVID's over, I really want to go to Leinster, which is a town of about 500 people. And I don't think being a foreigner, having traveled through Toronto or London, would be a welcome addition to their community. So I'm going to wait. And I don't know that I can afford to be hospitalized in Scotland. So I'm going to wait till we're a little better. Yes?
Are you familiar with the book Landscape and Memory?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm actually rereading it for probably the third time.
Yeah.
If any of you are interested in the book, it's by
Simon Shama.
Thank you. It's an amazing book, and he goes through stories of people remembering through the landscape. Mm-hmm. And it's something over my head, so that's
probably me too.
Yeah, but I love it. And the things he talks about in the book are very much my beliefs, just verbalized. So it's really nice to read.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, and that's the details for it.
Okay. Well, I tried.
Well, that's good. Anything else?
But is the glass box is quite heavy?
My husband carries them all. They're just fine.
We have a question from Facebook Live here, and Andrea Rankin is asking, "What do you call your art?"
Good question. I think we've been calling it cast frit. There is a reference, you guys will know this, of pâte de verre, but because I use no liquid, pâte de verre is a process where you mix your glass and put it in layers with a liquid binder. I use no binder. If I trip on the way to the kiln, it's all powder, it's gone skew. So I don't call it pâte de verre, so it's just kiln cast frit.
Thank you. We have another question from Lori Nelson. She's asking, what's your next project?
Surviving this one. it's been kind of busy. I just shipped work to a show in Montreal at McGill that opens September 17th. And I have a show, Eno Gallery, in Bloomfield. Is just going to the Hampton Art Fair, which is going to be online this year, which is maybe why they're going, but which is great for me. So those are my two projects for the near future. Other than that, this winter I'm taking a glass history course through Corning Museum of Glass. I'm taking a torch working course with borosilicate through Corning, and another professional artist course.
And you're giving a glass casting workshop here.
Yes!
Although the exact date has yet to be scheduled, so stay tuned.
Sometime in January. Oh, and I'm doing a talk here on October 1st.
That's right, at noon.
At noon, that's right.
And that's going to be a partnership with Science North. So it's going to be an interesting discussion, we think, between the contrast and conflict between a pristine wilderness and the need for economic opportunity.
So it would be a more conversational talk, and some different things might come up. So if you're in the area, you're welcome to come to that too.
And how long will this show be on?
This show will be on until December 24th, for certain, maybe a little bit.
And does it have another place on its route?
It goes after here, next summer, it's in Waterloo, Clay Glass Gallery. Mm-hmm. And that'll be number 5 on its stop. Mm-hmm. So.
We have another question here from Facebook Live from Julie McMahon.
McMahon.
That's what she says. She says, so Cher, what does your husband think of your art?
Maybe you'd like to ask my husband.
I love it.
Good answer.
Okay, do we have any more questions from Facebook Live? Oh, here we are. Andrew Rankin, do you sell lots of your art?
Depends what you call them. It's enough to sustain me as an artist, so no, I'm not rich, but it's enough to keep me going.
And you're represented by how many galleries and what are their names?
Thank you.
We won't be able to find you. I know that we have pieces here that are available at the gift shop at the Douglas Family Art Center.
Thank you. And then Sandra Ainsley in Toronto, Eno Gallery in Bloomfield, La Guild in Montreal, Gallery 10 in Edinburgh.
Harrison?
Yeah, Harrison Gallery in Key West. And I think I'm missing somebody. Oh, La Pie in Ottawa. Yeah. Oh, did I forget? Oh, yell at me. And Fragile Glass in Tora does have some of my cast there.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a grenade, and I've got a cutie dog.
There you go, yes. And some ravens.
Ravens are like fused.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, yeah. The fused.
But in
sorry.
Casting, I have a grenade.
And a cutie dog.
And a cutie dog.
Yes.
Hmm.
So
opposite of the green leaf.
Okay. Right. Well, wonderful. If there's no other questions, thank you so much, Cheryl, for your work, your talk, your exhibition. The show is on, as we said, until December 24th. There is another talk that Cheryl is giving on October 1st at noon. And if anybody has any questions to follow up, feel free to do so on our Muse Facebook page. We'll be happy to ask Cheryl on your behalf and get back to you. So thank you very much, Cheryl.
Thank you.